Hey everyone, and welcome to the HWBot World Tour 2016. This is the day 3 face-off final. We will see Dan Kopp against Extreme Addict. I'm Truthman from Overclocking TV, and we'll be commenting live this face-off alongside with Lee Goft, our overclocking expert. Hey Lee Goft.
Hey man, how you doing?
All great, all great. So we have two of the most prominent overclockers here today facing off in this day 3 of the HWBot World Tour. It's Extreme Addict from Poland versus Dan Kopp from Germany.
Indeed, it will be like an interesting match because, as you said previously, indeed, Extreme Addict was one of the, say, current top rankers, and Daniel has taken over like the last 2 years, I think, almost. So also one of their final chances to get that final ticket to Berlin on Saturday. So one of them will qualify and the other one might have his last shot tomorrow. But they are also participating in the G-Skill event, which is on the show floor here as well. So maybe they have to make a choice which they prefer, go to Berlin or take the cash prize at G-Skill, or claim both.
That would be interesting if one of them could claim actually both of these competitions. That would be actually a very nice display for them to know. So yes, I can do it. I can win two competitions in the same day. Well, let's say that's going to be a very tough race for them.
Yeah, indeed. That's also, first of all, the stress of the 1v1. Second, indeed, the stress from which choices do I make now? Because in a few minutes, they will like discuss about which benchmark they will choose. They can veto it, yes or no. Yeah, a lot of stress going on. And we can already see at the body language of one of the overclockers, indeed, that the stress level is building up slowly but steadily.
That's always the trick for them, to make sure that they can get this system. So as you see, they have their system on the platform, on the desk here, and they both use the same system.
Yeah, indeed. Today is Aces Day, if we can call it like that. Both benching on the brand new Rampage edition versus 10, so the 10th year anniversary edition of the ROG series. Both also did a qualifier on the board, so they don't have like any problem like on settings and stuff like that. However, we must say that they have to start the 1v1 with, let's say, an optimized default setup. So they have to dial in everything quickly when firing up.
This is interesting because they cannot just set up everything before and just go on the stage. As well, the CPU have been drawn just before they get on the stage, so they don't know which CPU they get. This is actually especially made to make the games completely fair for them. They don't know the CPU yet. They will have to test it, push it to the maximum, and make sure they can actually reach the best score ever in the next 30 minutes.
Yeah, indeed, and it all depends on which benchmark they will choose on. Both players, one veto. Let's see what happens. Maybe we can zoom in already a bit on what hardware they're currently using, and we can maybe comment a little bit then, as well as you guys following on Twitch, so the online viewers. If you have like any question, we'll try to reply to most of them.
So let's give a shout out to the guys on the live chat. Say hi from Neul. Neul, a French guy. AloTX, Velocity, HWBot, Jan Bonden, Journey007. Jorn, that's actually Jacob from Czech Republic. Northern okay. Killer, and Konija, and Speedfastest.
Konija, what?
Justin Ditsonic. Oh, C-Sonic, so that's maybe part of the our supporters. And Jiaobao. My dear Lee Goft, what can you expect from this match between Dan Kopp on the left and Extreme Addict on the right?
Well, like I said, both players are really experienced in the game, so I don't think any benchmark has any secrets for them. They know how to tune, how to tweak. It all will be a matter of which hardware they are given. There's always some luck involved, even though the CPUs have been pre-bent. There's always some, yeah, you have to have a perfect mount. Everything has to be right, dialed in, properly working. And XA is still working really hard. So XA is the opponent on the right-hand side of your screen from Poland. Maybe future president of Poland, I've heard. He has some ambitions to go soon into a political career. But yeah, he's still setting up while Daniel's already like slowly exploring in the BIOS and dialing it in.
So the question is how these two guys happen to be here today in the face-off. This goes back to the qualifier that we had to run for 3 hours earlier today. At the end of these 3 hours, they had three benchmarks. They have to do the best score they can in it. Turned out that Extreme Addict managed to be first in two of the three stages.
Yeah, true.
Ruf from Sweden was actually very well placed and very consistent over clicker. He managed to be second in the overall ranking, and Dan Kopp ended up being third in this ranking. The only reason is these three guys win cash. Extreme Addicts already won $500. Ruf already won $250, and Dan Kopp already won $125. This is the cash they already won from the qualifier. But as the HWBOT World Tour is a world tour of seven different events over five continents over the complete year, there is one big championship at the end of the year. We will take the two best people from each day, make them compete for them to access the final on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Indeed, true.
The question is, why Ruf is not in the face of today? The reason is he already got his ticket to go on the final on Saturday.
Yeah, on day one indeed he beat Hassan in the show-off. So Ruf already had his ticket or his reservation to qualify on Saturday again for the big final. So yeah, maybe Dan Kopp could be his lucky day. He just missed out to do the 1v1, but indeed due to the already qualification of Ruf on day one, he can do the face-off. So maybe his luck is on his side today.
And as we were talking, so the three guys already won cash today, and we have the face-off to see who will access the semi-final on June 4th. This is Saturday. That would be Friday evening for everyone living in the US, actually North America or South America. That will be Friday night for you guys. My dear Legos, I can't wait for Saturday. That will be very, very tight. But let's focus on the two guys today. Can you present a little bit more Extreme Addict and what were his achievements along the year?
Well, Extreme Addict Michael Vobochil is one of the, let's say, always competitors which is present in every online or live event that we have seen till now. This guy, like his nickname mentions, in fact, he's like really extreme, always pushes hard, especially in these competitions. He will not leave one megahertz untouched. If he can push harder, push more, he will do so. Sadly, Michal is now having some small technical problems, I think, and we don't have that many minutes left before we start. Miha is like Daniel. It's like usually we have like 2D benchers, so most doing processor benchmarks and 3D. Miha handles them all. Same for Daniel, in fact. So currently the number one ranked overclocker in the world from Germany has come from, I think, water cooling only like 2 or 3 years back. So really made like a huge step forward with the extreme cooling type. So went straight to liquid nitrogen, trained by Der Bauer. So at that moment, let's say the better overclocker in Germany. And yeah, he surpassed his Jedi.
It very interesting to see, because Dan Kopp is actually the number one overclocker in the world on the HWBOT ranking, and Extreme Addict is the second best overclocker in the world. So this is truly the best match of the week that we can get. This is number one against number two. This will be a very tight race because both of these overclockers are, they're real winners. You know, they like to fight on score. They usually fight on scores online, to submitting the scores and run after the other to make sure they just stay in the lead, but just trying to show who is the best one today.
Yeah, indeed. It's like I said, they will not leave one megahertz untouched and really will push it to, hopefully not till it breaks, but to go as far high as possible. Hopefully we'll see the same matches as we saw yesterday, but both players really motivating one another and really pushing the scores. Each time they submit that, we will see like a new score and just putting the pressure on the other player again that he needs to improve.
I just got the information from actually the organization team that the board that XA had, so his motherboard was having some issue and he was actually completely dead. I don't know what he did with the system. I hope that the CPU is fine, because that's there's no replacement for CPUs at all. So he's actually getting a new board. So I just got the information. Basically, I received the information that say this XA board is dead, but he's getting a new one. So now we will be able to go on the match in the next few minutes. This is pushing a little bit further the planning. So we will have to wait for them to choose of the benchmark. Speaking of benchmark, there is actually 12 benchmark that can come out of this, random draw today.
You all know them by heart. I don't.
No, I know. I can't remember all by heart. There's no way I can remember all of them. But I know that they all use the same hardware, they will all use the same board, they will all use the same CPU, the same memory, and the same SSD, and the same PSU. So let's go through it. So they use the Seasonic 760-watt PSU, the Platinum Edition. That's the one everyone has been using at all the HWBOT World Tour and the HWBOT World Series, the qualifier series for the HWBOT World Championship. They are all using today Asus board. That's the Rampage 5 Edition 10. They're all using ZADAC 511 memory and SSDs. This new brand that was actually discovered here at Computex 2016. They are, of course, using the latest Intel CPU, the Intel Extreme Core i7-6950X. This is the Broadwell E CPU. This CPU just launched this week. It was launched on Tuesday. So it's the very first time that this CPU have been overclocked that much. And this is the first time they have been displayed on the public for this kind of competition.
Yeah, indeed. And it has been some exploration for most of us, some, let's say, pro overclockers, so the guys that are really close to the HQs, or we had these CPUs but early test samples a while back, but usually the silicon changes a little bit, and of course that makes a lot of difference, because the things you were testing like 2 months ago maybe, and the current, maybe, let's say, close to retail versions that we're using here at the HWBOT booth.
That's something that a lot of people tend to forget. Gaming is a huge market, but keep in mind that to have this gaming motherboard on the market, or this gaming product on the market, when it comes to the CPU, the graphic card, and pretty much like the memory and the motherboard, if there was no overclocker, you will just get the design and not the performances out of it. It is very important to understand that over the past decade, like 10, 15 years, the involvement of the overclockers in this industry were actually a bit of an underground thing, because that was a niche market. But nowadays, their influence has been so widespread that they can influence on the product themselves, not on the design for the colors and so on, but on the way to build the VRM. I have one example I usually give on the people when we explain that is, 10 years ago, we had to modify physically the motherboard. This is not the case at all anymore for the past 4 years. The reason is we push so much as overclockers to make this change on the system for everyone to have access to it. So that means when you buy a motherboard today, there was years and years of feedback from this overclocking community to put back in the design of this product.
Yeah, that's true. The manufacturers really embraced, let's say, the overclockers, because they go so deep into the BIOS and really wanted more performance, that they even made own software tools and even, like you said before, modifications to the board just to get it clocking higher. So even some overclockers from, let's say, a while back are now working at the companies themselves.
And they're usually working here in Taipei, Taiwan. So that's why we always like to come to Computex to see them and enjoy a chat with them. Ligoft, that's going to be soon the time for the face-off. The first thing they will have to do is to draw the benchmark. One benchmark out of 12 benchmarks. They are mostly CPU dependent, but they can be influenced by the memory as well. Personal taste for you, what would you prefer? Just raw frequency, or you would also like to have just benching a little bit on the memory?
No, I'd rather have like a little bit of both. You know why? Because if you like lucky and you get like a CPU that runs maybe 100 megahertz higher than the other one, than the other competitor, you got it in the bag. But if it also includes like tweaking the memory, getting the memory frequency up, maybe tuning the timings and stuff like that, it requires more skill. Taking into account that you only have like 30 minutes, you have to work really, really rapid. You have to know your stuff. Both guys, in fact, know the ASUS board inside out. They have been working on it like the entire week. Also did like pre-testing on the test versions before. So these guys know how this board really functions and how it works, even how it ticks. So there's no problem for them like to dial in really quickly. It must be said that they cannot use like profiles. Usually if you have like, an overclocking board and you find like a good setup, you can save a profile. This is not allowed. So they have to dial it all manually before they cool down.
That means they have to understand completely what they want to do, and they need to know exactly what they want to do in the BIOS.
Indeed, and of course it also will make a little bit of difference which benchmark will be drawn first, because it's just a lucky draw, I think. And then they have the chance to veto it. They both have one veto. So let's say if it's XTU and Daniel says, oh yeah, okay, I'll veto that. XTU is not my cup of tea. The next benchmark that will be selected, XA or Extreme Addict, might veto it. And finally, they end up with a third one. Might be a benchmark that they really don't like. But that's, of course, how it runs, how it works out.
No, this is all part of the game, choosing the right benchmark, choosing who you veto on or what you veto not on. That would be very tricky for them. Do you know if some of these benchmarks have their like favorite benchmark?
Well, both are memory tweakers. So even DanCop and XA, there's like a benchmark called SuperPy32M where you have to calculate all these millions of digits. And it really requires like really huge memory bandwidth. So you really have to, even overclock the memory on liquid nitrogen to push the timings really hard, really far. So you can also push massive voltages. It's only a short benchmark. It only takes usually around 5 to 6 minutes, but you have to get the CPU frequency as high as possible, cache frequency as high as possible, memory frequency as high as possible, and tune in the timings. Really a lot of work to get like a few milliseconds gain that make the difference between being number one or maybe just rank in the top 20.
This is a huge difference. And at this level, it is super, super, super close and super, super tight for them. Come on, like between these two guys, number one overclocker in the world versus the number two overclocker in the world. These guys are at the top of the game today. They are here to defend the title. So basically, if Xtrematic is winning today, he can say to Denkop, I bet you, I bet the number one. I used to be the best one in competition last year. I'm back in the game.
Yeah, and the thing is as well, for these competition, they gain like what we call competition points. So these are also like included in the ranking. So if XA wins it, it's like with tennis, you have these movements in the ranking. And for the overclockers, in fact, it's the same. If you, the more you participate in competition, the more competition points you gain. And if, of course, you can beat the current number one, that's always nice, isn't it?
It is always nice, of course, and that's a great display of skill at this level. I think we will soon be, so we will be starting in about 15 minutes. So we will see with the different judge how that will be going. For all the guys on the live chat, thank you very much. Let us know who you will be supporting here. Will this be Denkop or will this be Xtrematic? We have to know who you are rooting for. That's always, you know, an interesting turnout of event. My dearly Goft, do you have a favorite overclocker here competing today? You are another overclocker, and you're usually competing against these guys. But if you have to choose a side, which one would that be?
Out of these two?
Yep.
I'm going to be.
Question,
I'm going to be defriended on Facebook. I only have two friends. They're both on the stage, so I lose one today. Nah, I don't know. I think Daniel he has the most pressure, I think. He really wants to be in Berlin as well. And it's like I said, he also competes at the G-School competition. And he told me, like, yesterday when we had that nice lunch at Galax, like, man, what I'm going to do? I'm, like, running out of time. I need to qualify to have my shot at that golden ticket on Saturday. So I need to do it tomorrow. Now he is on stage, so it's time to just do it.
And you can see, you can feel it in his face, like, yeah, I'm a bit stressed. And we were actually asking them if they want to, you know, just get interviewed just before the show, and they say, no, not before, because we want to make sure that everything is working and so on. You guys will be able to see exactly everything that is going on their computer once the match starts. They are just preparing the setup, just making sure that everything is dialed in correctly. So we will make sure that you know, everything can go smoothly.
Yeah, and XA has got his board already up and running, so his replacement board, let's say it like that. The thing is, normally you have to insulate a board, but this is only like a 30-minute show off, so it's not. It's important that you insulate, but it's not that important if you want to run like for hours in a row. So that's why XA could like really prepare this motherboard like, let's say, in a flash of an eye.
If you want to give a little glimpse about what's going on, we can actually see Xtrematic is modifying some of the settings in the system just to optimize. That's the basic optimization from the OS that the two overclockers can do. They are very dialing into all the options to make sure that, you know, they can get the right the right performances for what they want.
Yeah, now he's just changing memory settings. So the max mem setting in the operating system. Why does he do that? Because we're currently using the B-die ICs, and really they put like a lot of strain on the internal memory controller of the processor. And now he lowered the value from 32 gigs to only less than 4 gigs. So he will increase stability. It might not be as fast, but at least the setup will be more stable. And even if something goes wrong with the memory, usually he could still continue to bench. As you can see, it's not only about raw frequencies, not only processor memory frequencies, but these guys are also tuning and dialing in the operating system the way that they want to. They just got a fresh SSD, so indeed a lot of work to do, and you only have like a little, that little amount of time to get everything dialed in right. So maybe I can understand the reason why they didn't want to have like the annoying interviewer with a beard like posing like all these stupid questions to entertain the people at Twitch.
So as you say, they got all the new, the completely new setup. They got a new CPU, they got a new SSD, they keep the RAM they had before, I guess. And that's basically it, because the most important things for them is the CPU is randomly drawn, so they have equal amount of chance. The SSD is completely fresh, so there is no issue about having some unauthorized software running on the SSD. They are not allowed to use USB key on the stage. That's the reason why they have to do it. They are not allowed to use the system profile in the board as well. So they have to really dial in, as you say, in the settings to make sure that they know exactly the system they are using today.
You know what I really would love at this moment?
A beer.
And a cigarette. Both are like really heavy smokers, and these are also best friends, because I know that Daniel invites Miha regularly, let's say twice or three times a year, from Poland to Germany to do like a bench session, like in a team, so they can both like have ideas, inputs, and how to clock some graphics cards higher or the latest hardware. So yeah, it's they're friends, but at this moment they're the biggest rivals.
That will be extremely interesting to see who will fight and how they will fight. As you can know, they are just going around. Maybe actually, Ixie just asked if he can go out for cigarettes. That's exactly what he just asked.
Yeah, they really needed to calm down, and then
and
also,
he's gone. So here we are, guys. This is the HWBOT World 2 2016 Asia. We're at the Computex in Taipei. I would like to give a big shout out to all the sponsors and partners of this event. First of all, Cyber Media and Computex Tetra. Tetra, the organizer of Computex, is supporting this kind of overclocking event. This is extremely awesome from you guys. Thank you very much. Intel, of course, making the fastest and most powerful processor in the world, is also part of this event, showing off the powerful the performance of the Intel Core i7 6950X, the latest Broadwell eCPU. ZADAC 511, one of the new brand that is now going on the market. They unveil all their new product line here at Computex just 2 days ago. Of course, there's AOC helping out with the monitors. Seasonic, the season partner for the HWBOT World Tour. Streacom and Thermal Grizzly. Streacom for the open bench table product that is used for the workshop amateur, and Thermal Grizzly that was providing some thermal paste. Big shout out to the guy on the media side, the guys at Kulaler, the Kulaler forum, that is one of the biggest forum here in Taipei, Taiwan. They're actually taking care of the workshop, making sure that everything is run smooth. They do the workshop in Chinese. So know if you pass by the Computex and you're actually not quite fluent in English, you can always take the workshop in Chinese. Of course, the big shout out to the guy at Overclock.net, OCN. They are the biggest platform in North America regarding computer and computer parts, like discussion and hardware. Awesome guys. I was actually 2.5 weeks ago in Toronto for one of their meetup. It was really nice to discuss with everyone. Like, there's a lot of fan of water cooling at OCN, and there's also a lot of overclockers there as well. Techmundo, the biggest IT portal in Brazil, is also part of this event. So everything you can see here, maybe there's some of you guys watching us from Brazil. That should be actually quite late in the night. And let us know actually where you are tuning from on the live chat. That's always interesting to know where you guys are from. And of course, OC eSport, your source for latest information about all the overclocking competition and overclocking TV here. That will never be an overclocking event without overclocking TV. The last shout out for the media I want to give is to Tom's Hardware, one of the biggest IT and one of the most visited website talking about the computer parts and reviews and so on. So if you have question about the new Broadwell eCPUs, the Core i7-6950X, you can go on OCN and Tom's Hardware to check out all their reviews.
Indeed, and we already had like a few questions on the Twitch channel as well, that people already were like, some of the overclockers that we're seeing over there, Van Butt from Germany indeed, wanted to know how good these ZADAC kits are. Yeah, it's difficult to say because we only test them on Broadwell E platform at this moment. So we really need to test them out on the previous Skylake platform, so what Intel calls the more mainstream platform, and there we can really let them loose and let them rip. So maybe some of the overclockers will test them on the other platform.
There's a few reasons for that. First of all, Broadwell is so new that you don't know exactly all the all the small settings that could influence on the maximum frequency you can reach with this this memory. The Z170 platform from Intel, the previous one, is actually much more matter because it's been a year that it's available on the market. So of course, you like, people are more accustomed to it, so all the settings you can dial in and so on. And as well, it's the way the platform is mounted. Broadwell, you can have four by two, like you can have 8 kits of memory at the same time, while Z170 can have a maximum of 4 at the same time. This all imply in the overclocking range. So that was usually some question like this.
Yeah, and, too, and also some people like asking like, why do you overclock this 10 core, this brand new 10 core CPU? People just have to more power. It's never enough. It's
we want more.
We want more. We always want to break our records, set new world records, maybe get some extra PR attention, maybe a job at some motherboard manufacturer or memory manufacturer, whatever it is. Yeah, we always want more. We want to improve. We want to evolve. Always faster scores. Lower milliseconds. Just why? Because we can.
Because we can is exactly the right answer. Because we can. It's like you get a car. You might get the fastest car on the market, and then what can you do with that? Well, I can go faster.
Yeah, sure. You can only drive it maybe 90 miles an hour on the motorway, but once you go to a track, you can really unleash the beast and use all the horsepower. You can drag race with it, you can do sprint races, whatever you want. So indeed, that's what overclocking is all about. This is, of course, extreme overclocking. This is, that's not a cut to do with it. So the benchmark draw has been completed, and we already talked about Intel extreming utility. And they really are going to limit it to 4 GHz. So in fact, something that you could do at home. This implies that both competitors really need to tweak the memory a lot, really find a good way to dial it in. They have to know which settings give them that extra bandwidth. And I think it will be a very, very close race. This will
We have the number one overclocker in the world facing the number two overclocker in the world. That would be quite interesting to see what can come out of this match. This is basically the shock of the Titan, right?
Yeah, and true. And it's just also about, look, I'm currently ranked number one, but you have to remain. It's already not easy to get up there, but to maintain there, it's insanely difficult because all these guys want to challenge you. They maybe get like slightly faster hardware, but thanks to your skills that you gained over the years, you might still, but it's a lot of work. I know that Daniel benches like 2 or 3 nights per week at least, just to improve his scores and get, or let's say, stay up there at the top of the pyramid.
That's the thing. To be on top of the ranking, you have to be consistent and to keep on going with the scores and everything. So that's actually super difficult for them to stay at this level as well.
Yeah, and you can, I can watch the faces on the stage. They're like already like both thinking like, how do I nail this? How do I eliminate my best friend? Just to get it done. And it's like, we will see. It will be a very, very, very close race. Even closer, I think, than yesterday, because we're limiting at 4,000 megahertz CPU. In fact, they don't even need liquid nitrogen, the CPU, for this benchmark.
So we are ready to go for the this match, my dearly Goft. Let's tune into the stage and see when we can go.
So indeed, some people like already wondering on the Twitch, why only 4,000 megahertz? Well, now they need to maybe use the liquid nitrogen to go higher on the cache, so on the on-core, as we call it. So probably we will see maybe speeds up to 4,400, 4,500 megahertz on cache speed. So that this is where like maybe they can gain the final or precious points to get the ticket to compete in the Saturday qualifier.
Intel Extreme Tuneability is one of the benchmarks that was made in collaboration between HWBot and Intel, and is being used a lot here as well in the workshop.
Indeed, and it is a benchmark that everybody has explored, and everybody is now sort of getting it sorted out. What works, which operating system you need to use, which memory timings have an influence, and it's really a complicated benchmark that is dependent on a lot of variable settings. So we're seeing both players in the BIOS and indeed setting the cache ratio to 4,000, so they probably are not allowed to go even higher. Now we're seeing that the memory frequencies are only like 3,200 megahertz. So with Skylake, we have seen frequencies over 4,000 megahertz, but due to the let's say the limitations of the integrated memory controller, they usually will be topping around maybe 3600-ish, dependent of course on the quality of the memory. So it's with overclocking as well, you're seeing already that we're seeing pink colors or red colors. So indeed, the voltages that these guys set are like way over the, let's say, the acceptable value for daily overclocking. But due to the fact that we're using like liquid nitrogen, so we're cooling minus degrees, it is no issue. The silicon survives and the electricity and stuff, the current keeps on flowing naturally, no problem. So just waiting till both players enter the operating system and we'll get the first scores in. So it took them already like quite a while because we're like already 2 minutes in the game and we haven't seen any player boot into the Windows. So they're just waiting for the board to boot. So we're seeing the 10th anniversary logo of the Republic of Gamers.
This is usually what we call the cooldown time, because they have to start the game by being above 0.0.
Indeed, but it's like I said, 4000 megahertz will not generate that much heat for the CPUs, but maybe they can use it to increase the stability of all the internal components. So thanks to SSDs, we get into the Windows pretty quick, and the player on the left, the red corner, is Daniel Scheer, so Dankop from Germany, and he's about ready to launch the first benchmark. You will, due to the fact that it's a 10-core CPU, it will go pretty quick. We have been benching the Pentium G3258 last year for the amateurs, and I think it took over 2 minutes to complete the benchmark. This will only take like maybe half a minute now. Fun thing about XTU is, in fact, it's a stress testing tool, like you said, developed in collaboration with HWBot and Intel, and you can see all these values at the bottom. CPU utilization, core frequency, temperature is been left out, sadly, for monitoring in this version. You can see the core voltage they're using, and we're almost done with the first core. So Danko placing his first placeholder, 2542.
And his reverting rate away in the same benchmark, just to see if he can just improve that.
Yeah, indeed. It will all go down into dialing in the BIOS, just adjusting them final timings, and then it's run, rerun. Sometimes if you run the benchmark several times after one another, you can get like 3 or 4 or maybe even more points increase. So it's always dependent on the total stability of the rig.
As you can see, soon a new score from Dankop will be. So he's limited at 4 GHz. There's always the maximum processor frequency that is being displayed. If this one is above 4 GHz, it won't work.
So you see, like, just a rerun 2640. So there's like a decent increase in points already done. So Saturated Fat09 asked, what's the 2542? Well, that's the score that XTU generates after he does like several loops of stress testing on the CPU cores, and that's the final score or the amount of calculation it took to do like the complete test. Yeah, indeed, it's just a benchmark score. So hopefully XA can go into the Windows and show us some, let's say, stiff competition for his best friend.
Well, let's say that we are waiting for XMatic to show his magic. We are 5 minutes into that daily phase of the day three here at the HWBot World Tour 2016. So far, Dankop, currently number one overclocker in the world, is leading with 2640 points. While XMatic, the current number two overclocker in the world, is still in the reach for his first score.
Indeed, and the thing that you will see right now is that they will lower the multiplier. So you will think, they will only be running at 3900. But due to the fact that the total processor frequency is built above two values, you have like the CPU multiplier, as we call it, and the B clock. So he's lowering the multiplier now and upping the B clock. This has an influence on two other values, the memory speed and the uncore cache. So the thing now, Daniel has to make sure that he's not breaching that 4003, I think, or 4001 is the max frequency they can have. So he really has to make sure that he doesn't surpass it, otherwise the score will not be validated.
So as you can see, both of the overclockers are back into the system, just trying to reboot the system to make sure that, you know, let's go to the BIOS, let's go to Windows, change the settings and continue on that.
So people already asking on the Twitch channel, what are we looking at? In fact, well, this is extreme overclocking. So we're overclocking or boosting the performance of our PC by software inside the Windows, or even like the guys, then XAS now at the moment inside the BIOS of the Asus Rampage version 10 board, and just changing a lot of values with a pumping a lot of volts, I must say, at this moment. And he's trying to boost the memory frequency at this moment to get like either the board booting at this moment, because he's struggling to get inside the Windows. And you see how quickly these guys like wade through all them numerous settings. So Daniel indeed now changing again the B clock from inside the Windows, and hopefully he will improve his score.
As you can see, they're using liquid nitrogen. It's a negative 200 degree, and they are using that one to cool down the CPU and the computer in general. Of course, when you're trying to overclock, it's going much, much higher in term of heat that is produced. So you have to remove that heat to continue on pushing the system to the limit. As we say earlier, this is limited to 4 GHz. So the memory will play a good role in that. And the reference clock will be quite important as well to reach that. So they can lower the multiplier, increase the reference clock.
Yeah, indeed. And Daniel has like maybe the more stable more stable settings at this moment, because he's always able to boot inside the operating system, while Extreme Addict is at the moment struggling to do so. So there was also a question on the Twitch channel if these CPUs were cherry picked. No, these are not the best CPUs that we've seen at the Computex Fair, but they were like bent nevertheless. So we took like sort of equal CPUs, that we didn't have like one guy running able to run like maybe 200 or 300 MHz than the other one.
So that means it's completely fair for the two overclockers there, and the only thing that can differentiate them from one or the other is their skills in making sure they can push this Intel Core i7-6950X to the limit.
Indeed, and then cop again at the OS and trying a new run, so probably he can beat his 2645 score that he has right now. And hopefully we can see Miha as well booting into the OS, because at the moment he's like really struggling to get the board into the OS, into the Windows 10 operating system.
This is the first time someone takes so long to actually get a first score in all the world tour that we did this year in 2016. This is the first time we are actually closing down to the 9 minutes barrier. This is a mental barrier, like the first 10 minutes. If you don't get a score, if you don't get your placeholder, basically, it's usually that you have a strong issue with your system. Either you are doing something too quick, or you're not thinking about all the system that you should have dialed in.
Yeah, indeed. And it could be like same that Miha's other board indeed was like booting at these speeds that he's setting in, or these settings that he's using right now. But this is also the difference between different motherboards, different CPUs, different memory kits. So you really have to find like a good, let's say, combination of it all. So Daniel working his way slowly up, getting 2640, but that's not enough to beat his previous score. So he needs to rerun and maybe change some other setting to get it over and done with. So XA is still again in the BIOS, slowly upping, and maybe he's just checking or verifying that this is a thing, of course, that we, let's say, not advise for the people at home to change too many values at one time, but these guys know the BIOS inside out, so they really know what works and what doesn't work normally. So Daniel's run almost completed again. Will we see something better than 2645?
2646. Actually, Daniel's score is actually going down.
Yeah. Hmm. Really bizarre. This could also be due to the fact that he's like indeed clocking the B clock. It could be that the memory trains a little bit different, and that indeed we have something what we call round trip latency, some memory value that indeed could lower the performance or the overall bandwidth of his memory.
Don't forget, guys, if you have questions on the live chat on Twitch, you can let us know. But let us know first who you are rooting for. There's people that were rooting for Dankop most of the time.
We forgot one thing.
What?
The raffle. Or is there no raffle today?
There's the giveaway, of course. Yeah, you're right. So there's a giveaway coming on our Facebook page. If you can just check it on overclocking.tv/raffle. during that time, the two overclockers are back in the system. We can see that Extreme Addict was tuning in with the process lasso to make sure that the process have the right priority of the system, while we can see that Dankov is still pushing.
So we finally nailed it, and he got like a 6-point increase again. You see, due to the limited frequency, the increase in difference in points is not really that big, and it could be that the winner just snatches the lead and the ticket for the finals, let's say the semifinals on Saturday, with maybe just 1 point difference. So XA now has to set all the things inside the Windows operating system as well, and from this moment on he can start clocking. So we're really looking forward to seeing what his score will be.
I think XA will soon be going for extreme training utility. Okay, go run that benchmark. Yes.
Yeah.
So here we are. This is the first run by Extreme Addict. Let's hope that this run will completely go through and make sure that he can get a score for his placeholder. There is more than 13 minutes. It's 13 minutes he was actually dialing in the system, like cooling down the CPU, dialing in the system. He managed to boot, and now he's looking to get his first score.
And indeed, you see the different approach between the two overclockers. Daniel's sticking, let's say, to the 100 strap, as we call it. He's slightly increased it to value to 102.7, while XA goes for the 125 strap, so he can has access to other memory multipliers at this moment. Waiting to see his score. Hopefully it's somewhere near 26, and he's now looking which process he can like put a higher priority on to really boost it. So probably the score will not be that great, but he's really tweaking and tuning the operating system at this moment. So Daniel matching his score again, 26.51, and it'll probably be rerun to get like those little futile extra points at this moment. So for the guys watching at the Twitch channel, so these scores, you can, let's say, compare all these scores. And even if you download this benchmark, it's free downloadable from the Intel website. I think that was 25.14?
No, that was 26.14.
Okay, 26.14. So indeed, XA is like getting into the game finally, and hopefully he will probably be able to match or maybe even surpass Daniel's score of 26.51. But Daniel running again.
This is actually strong. That's the first score of XA. Took him a long time, almost half of the game. We are just you are already more than 15 minutes into the game, and that's the first score from Extreme Addict. He waited a long time, but maybe he got an edge. Maybe he got an edge on his opponent here, Dankov, by setting up and going to that 125 bootstrap that he can access more memory timings and actually more memory frequencies. Maybe he's dialing in directly to this path.
Yeah, and he's really working with the Lasso tweaking utility that you can also download from the internet. And he's really looking for which software is like really stressing my cores. He wants to put them at a higher affinity, like you see, real-time highest, so maybe it will give a slight boost. We have seen this with pre-Skylake platforms, that this software tweak, if we can call it like that, really boosts the score. So Daniel now going for the same approach. So Daniel in the BIOS at the moment, also going for the 125 strap. Maybe we told too much on the live chat and giving away XA's tweaks.
It's a public event. This is a public one versus one. Of course, people will know what the other guy will be using, so that makes sense to for them to know. Jump on it. The approach of
XA, so increasing his points with 10 points, but he still has like this lasso tool like fully running in the background. So even if he minimizes that one, the score might be a little bit higher.
So what does actually Process Lasso is doing for them?
So indeed, like I said, you have all these services running around or running in the background in your Windows operating system. And now he's like really tweaking which process will get like a higher priority from his CPU. So he will go to let's say, the extreme tuning utility is built up from Prime 95. Maybe some people at home, that rings a bell. That was one of the major, let's say, stressing tools or stability tools in the past. And this is like a nice graphical layout, but I would say this Prime 95 thing integrated in the XTU is really harsh on your CPU. It's really a CPU crusher.
This is made to test the most of your CPU, what you can do, and how you can push it to the maximum. This is usually test used as a stress test.
Yeah, indeed. And the fun thing is you have all these values that you can monitor. You don't need like extra software to install. Free downloadable, really easy to test, really easy to, let's say, run as well. And the fun thing is, like I said before, Christian interrupted us with the score, is you can compare your results with all the other people online. So you can see, he has the same CPU running at the same frequency as mine, but still, I don't know. So maybe you will start to get more into of the tweaking of your memory, of your software, to get maybe a better score. And that's how most of us like came into overclocking, in fact.
These guys are actually at negative 80 degrees. This is to cool down the CPU and keep it at 4 GHz.
Yeah, it's like I said, normally for these frequencies, you don't even need liquid nitrogen, but they're pushing like the uncore ratio really high. And just the extra cold might keep the CPU a little bit more stable during this stress test. And that's all they need. They don't need like minus 120. It's no need that they go this low. And
XA is still in the process lasso, and Dan Cup is actually still benching.
Yeah. XA needs like what I have to look like over 30 points to snatch the lead. So that's quite a substantial amount of points he needs to do. Daniel running, rerunning, and you see, it's like we said, the scores like keep there. Yeah, it's between 2640, 2645, 2651. So it's like we said, if you're running at a limited frequency, you will always need to have like maybe this lucky shot, this lucky run that just gives them extra points to claim the ticket for Saturday's finals.
You can see Dan Cup is like, wait, I don't understand, it's so low, so slow. His benchmark and the one he's running is sometimes doing slower than before. It's weird.
No, it's not weird. We know why. He doesn't. It's something I experienced myself while benching as well this afternoon, that it's not all about the memory, this.
Don't say it out loud, they will know.
Okay.
Can see Dan Cup here, not quite sure about what he can do.
Yeah, and we're over halfway, we're even approaching the 10 minute mark, so that's not that much time left, in fact, to improve. So probably XA will reboot and has got everything dialed in well in the operating system. Let the system reboot post, and hopefully we'll get a score that might come close to Daniel.
Daniel is not quite sure about that. He's like shaking his head and say like, damn, this, I need more, I need more, I need more power for that. 2645 again, so it's not matching his best score even. So he will have to reboot the system, go into the BIOS, change the setting and start again.
Yeah, and I did a memory test on the previous platform on Haswell E, and I really found out some interesting stuff, especially regarding this benchmark, that at a certain moment it doesn't scale anymore with memory frequency. It's all about getting everything dialed in properly in the memory. It's not that more at a certain moment is better. You need at least 3200-ish megahertz, but even if you run it at 2400 megahertz with X99 platform, apparently it doesn't scale anymore.
As we say, this CPU and this plat, like this new Broadwell E CPU, is actually brand new this week. So a lot of the overclockers know a little bit about it, but not everything, not all the settings that can influence on the general overclocking. So that would be, you know, maybe in 2 months from now, they will know more exactly about the complete platform and, you know, have more details to go in deep in the settings and, you know, dial into the right settings.
Yeah, and it's even for the people who designed the motherboards, in fact, and the BIOS engineers as well, that explore new settings, or maybe even due to the fact like we have these what we call show-offs on the G-Skill booth. Like each day also a vendor has their time and moments of glory to show off and see what they can do. And I can say, why is the competitive product like way faster than ours? And they will try to compare, and probably they will find some setting that might appear in the Asus BIOS and the other brand doesn't even have that setting because they have hidden it in the BIOS. They might unlock it so you can adjust it.
But here today, you have to keep in mind that the CPU is a new architecture. The platform is new for most of them. And the memory, no one knew that memory before. We are using ZADAC 511. So this memory, DDR4 memory, are completely new to all the overclockers right here, right now.
Yeah, indeed, and still trying to push 26 or surpassing 26:51. We'll see what Daniel can pull off. He's again, I think, maybe on the 100 strap and trying like his initial approach of getting a decent setup or decent score in. So at the moment, the current number one overclocker, if we can say it for the HW bot ranking, is the person on the left currently leading Dan Kopp. Daniel Scheer from Germany has been, I think, topping the ranking for the last 1.5 years, maybe even almost 2 years. So, like we said, it's a hard way to get to the top, but even harsher to maintain the current lead because all these people want to push you off your throne. So XA again, tweaking, tuning the operating system, and he has to remember that there's less than 8 minutes left. So what we have to say is, if you launch the benchmark a few seconds before the end of the competition, it's allowed that the benchmark completes the run. So sometimes we have to wait maybe 30 or 40 seconds longer than the official time to see what the output is.
As you say, the key is to not go over 4 GHz for this specific match here between Dan Kopp, currently number one overclocker in the world, and XA, currently number two overclocker in the world. And as you say, there is less than 8 minutes, 8 minutes in this game daily face-off at Day 3 for the HW Bot World Tour 2016. There's a lot of people here at Computex passing by the booth and checking about like these two best overclocker in the world, now fighting to see who can access for a ticket on the final on Saturday.
Yeah, and the interesting part you're seeing on Denkop's screen right now, probably will close it, is that you can adjust the memory values on X99. So XA increasing his points by only 5, so not really enough. So he really needs to do more, maybe ditch the lasso and just get up to dialing something else in. Daniel running again.
So the benchmark on XTU, this benchmark is used by all the overclockers to compete on the ranking on HWBot. So they are quite used to this benchmark, like they all use it from time to time or so much depending on their affiliation with it. And 4.01. So was that score still valid?
I don't think so. But it's not my call. It's Christian Ney, so the person in the middle of both overclockers holding the microphone, who validates the score, yes or no. So he has the entire responsibility indeed, if the score is legit, yes or no.
Both of the overclocker are now benching XTU. You can see at the core frequency in the monitoring pan in the bottom of each of the screens, the 4 GHz is the core frequency, the maximum core frequency that they are running at. They should not go above 4 GHz.
Well, Saturated Fat 09 has a question on Twitch. I think you guys with OCTV did some slacker benching, or how was it called again? The video?
Scatterbencher.
Scatter benching. Yeah, sorry for that. So we're going to link it to a small video just explaining the basic principles of overclocking. It's really doesn't take a long time to watch. I think something about 10 minutes, and they give you like a good run through. I think it's only based on Intel CPUs at this moment, but the principle for even for the AMD architecture is practically the same.
We are here at the HWBot World Tour 2016 at Computex, and we are having Dan Kopp, currently number one overclocker in the world, fighting against Extreme Addy, currently number two overclocker in the world, and they're trying to decide to see who will access the final on Saturday to be run here to win one of the last two remaining golden tickets for the HWBot World Series.
And Daniel going for the reboot again, maybe trying a final adjustment in the BIOS to get it up and running. And XA really struggling to get it over or near the region that Daniel really has put down, I think, a really solid score. And XA really, even with all the tweaking and software thing, he's not even coming close to that score of 26:51 at this moment. So you can still see the stress on both faces, both heavily concentrated and really trying to think. I think that if you could like measure the brain action, or reach, maybe they need also liquid nitrogen to cool down their brains because they're running in overdrive mode at this moment, really trying to nail it.
There's a different approach for these overclockers, as you can see in the early match. Xtrematic was like trying to boot as a high setting first, and while Dankop boot at a safe setting and build up from that one.
Yeah, indeed, it's like something you always ask the question, what's the tactics for these approaches? First to get down a solid score. something that already like impresses your opponent, like, oh, this is the mark that I need to reach already to be competitive with this guy. And Daniel went straight up like to his solid score, I think even better than many people have done on the amateur, let's say, boot, because these guys were even clocking higher and didn't even reach over 2600.
This is an impressive display of skills by these two overclockers. Of course, they have this limitation that should not go above 4 GHz, so they have to play with every other settings around the CPU frequency. And there's a lot of question actually from the people here passing by, like, oh, what is the maximum frequency that you can have? Maximum frequency is just one thing. It's just one part of the game. Part of the game is to have the complete system dialed in, to have the complete system working as fast as you can.
Indeed, and Xe is going for the maximum frequency of the memory, less than 3 minutes, so approaching the 3 minutes. We have a small delay on the Twitch, so officially we have less than 3 minutes to go. Xe running now, memory frequency 3500 megahertz, so let's see if that pays off to come closer to Dan Kopp's score of 2651. Daniel also in the operating system now, opening the Memtweaked tool from ASUS. So he's going to verify the timings that the motherboard set and maybe even put them a little bit more tighter. Sometimes you just need to boot inside the OS, and maybe you can lower a few settings right now, and maybe they're just enough to get everything up and running to maybe even increase his lead over XA at this moment.
Both of the overclockers need to fight. They have 2 minutes and 20 seconds left in this day three face-off. They have to find out who is the best overclocker for today in this face-off, fighting on XTU limited at 4 GHz. These two overclockers are currently number one, Dan Kopp, and number two, Extreme Addict. Let's see what can get out of this next run for the benchmark.
Yeah, and Xeo, even with his high memory frequency, couldn't even nail over 2500K. Maybe it was a bugged run, but he only had 2494, so really low or really below his normal score that he had before.
The score for XA is coming soon.
So he's remaining around the same region, the same mark, 2629, 2624, 2625. So he needs 30 points to snatch the win or the ticket to get to end. 1 minute, 30 seconds to go.
Keep in mind, guys, that they have to launch the benchmark before the end of the counter. They have to launch these benchmark before. If the benchmark is launched after, it doesn't count, it doesn't apply. But if the benchmark is launched just before, even at the last second, it will apply for the score.
So, here we go. Daniel coming close again to his normal score, 2645. So, hopefully, he can put down some extra points right now. So, Snow Bandit, 2635. XA closing in the final, let's say, minute of the game. The heat is on.
Still, it is 21 point, more than 20 point difference between them. That's going to be super, super tight. But you never know. You never know. Maybe at the last minute, XA will run the benchmark and just have 1 point more than Dan Kopp.
Yeah, that would be like amazing if he can pull that one off. But indeed, he has no more time to reboot. Only 30 seconds left. Like I said, they can just run, rerun, and hopefully hit that final score that might beat the competitor. So XA's run almost finished. 26:35. It will not be enough. 15 seconds to go.
15 seconds, do we have time to relaunch the benchmark? Yes, you were on the benchmark again.
This is. It's officially over, but they are still able to complete this run, so we have to really sit it out and see what the final scores will be. 26:51, current lead.
So the first score to appear would be the one from Dan Kopp. Let's see if he can do more than 26:51.
Oh, close again, but not good enough. 26:45 again. Now XA coming.
Ah.
No. It's over, and Dan Kopp indeed qualifies for Saturday's finals. So indeed, the current number one overclocker indeed beating his best friend and number two ranked Polish overclocker Extreme Addict. So Dan Kopp still number one and shows it off again that he's there's a reason why he's there now. So really nice tight fight. So well done for Daniel. I think he will be very happy with this win because he really needed that win to qualify for Saturday.
This is quite impressive to see him. He was in the final of the AWBOT World Tour 2016 and he lost against his fellow countryman Bullshooter. He's back in the game. He's back in his game. Now he will have a chance to go to the semi-final on Saturday to defend his title to get the golden ticket for the AWBOT World Championship that will be happening here in Taipei, Taiwan on Saturday.
Yeah, indeed. And for all the other overclockers in the extreme boot, tomorrow indeed is also their final day. So they really have to get their gear going. And I see Lucky Noob already smiling. He probably will be ready tomorrow to nail them final three stages to get the 1v1 done and maybe also claim for a spot to get the final ticket to go to Berlin.
That would be interesting to see because tomorrow will be the last day for someone to get to the game on Saturday. But I can't wait to see what the other guys can do during the qualifier because the top three of each qualifier always get cash and the face-off just decide who is going to the Saturday matches to get the golden ticket.
Yeah, indeed. It's a tight game and I'm not really for these low clock challenges, but indeed it overrules. If anybody has like a frequency advantage over the other one, now it's all down to tweaking, knowing your hardware, knowing your settings, knowing how the benchmark like needs, does it need memory bandwidth? Does it need more cache frequency? Does it need tighter timings? It's a lot of things like that go through these overclockers' head and them final 30 seconds.
My dear Ligov, so what can we say about this specific match between the two best overclockers in the world? What was your feeling about this match here?
I think the approach that both did, like Dankop starting off with 100 strap, indeed, like you said, like doing a placeholder, but that score was like directly really high. He did not mess that much with the lasso tweaking tool and the operating system. So I think, yeah, he might have done maybe a little bit more preparation on the XTU beforehand, because I don't know what these overclockers are aware, which were the benchmarks included in the suit. I don't know if they knew which benchmarks were available or on this AWBOT World Tour Stop Asia.
So here we have Dan Kopp accessing the final on Saturday. Let's talk about the skills that they can that they display in the in this match. What do you think about the skill about Extreme Addict and the cooldown? It took him a lot of time to actually get a score for the first time. Like almost 13 minutes into that game before he make the first score.
I think he's really lucky to be in number two position because this should not happen. Of course, he it's not his fault that his board that he received was dead. This already like put a lot more stress on him to get like a second board prepared and maybe the timings, like I said, that he could run during the qualification were not picked up by the new board, and maybe he had to just readjust and just find a way to get the board first of all posting again, booting into Windows, and then I think the first placeholder that he set indeed was like I need a lot of points to catch up, and we're like at this limited frequency, so it comes all down to tweaking.
And especially at 4 GHz, you know, they have to control the temperature as well, because if you cannot go too cold, because you just see them going to hang up and freeze, and you cannot just stay too high, otherwise you don't have the same performances of the memory controller as well. So you need to balance all these settings at the same time. So it's like you are driving a Formula One on a regular road race where there's a lot of turns, and you have to, you know, get all these different settings in mind for you to drive the best way.
Yeah, indeed. You have to, like you said, it's comparing. You have to like good cornering technique, but at a certain moment, you cannot surpass certain speeds. So it's really difficult. You really need to be like really concentrated and focused. And yeah, these guys have enough experience to do these kinds of events. But you see, even with all the skill that they have and all the experience that they have built up over the years, it was not, I think, not close enough for XA. I don't think he will be like really happy about his performance, or maybe the motherboard is a potato, as he likes to express.
As he likes to say, he's always say that this piece of hardware is potato when he doesn't manage to get the most out of it. But keep in mind that tomorrow there's also a 1 day again for qualifier. That's going to be day four, and you have the chance to qualify again. He has the chance to end up in the top two of the qualifier, get into the face-off, and maybe win his place to the semi-final on Saturday.
Indeed, tomorrow is Gigabyte Day, I think. So the guys doing the show off have to use the Gigabyte board and also have to use the Gigabyte board on Saturday then. So then Daniel can use his favorite motherboard. I think he is really close to, let's say, the Asus RG, R&D team. So I think he's really happy that he nailed the stage today. So he can use a motherboard that he's really acquainted with and that he knows like inside out on Saturday.
What do you think about the skills of both of the overclockers regarding the tweaking of the benchmark? We saw that Dan Kopp did not tweak that much the benchmark. It was just running it and changing the settings to make it run stable, while actually Xtrematic was always doing change with Process Lasso to try to get the first, to hide the priority and so on. So what do you think about that? Like, could Dan Kopp get some more point if he was playing with the Process Lasso as well?
Well, I think the Process Lasso has been well explained on HW.org site as well in the forum. And I don't know, normally it's only like finding the right processes in the Windows. And there's only like one command line normally that you need to type in, and then you have to leave it alone. Because Daniel also had it running in the background, but he no longer touched it. So it was like running minimized, probably low priority. And Xe was constantly running it fully maximized in the background. And I don't think it really got it going for XA. I don't think the Lasso did his job on his setup. And that might explain the small difference or the small edge that Daniel kept during the entire 30 minutes.
That was actually quite impressive. As you can see, the guys are packing up on the stage. We will take a short break and come back with the debrief of this match with the winner, Dan Kopp, to see what it was about for this game. And we'll see you guys tomorrow.
My cigarette break. I think you have to wait for the cigarette break now for those guys.
I would love to actually catch Dan Kopp before a cigarette break. That would be quite awesome. So this way we can just do it super quick. So guys, stay in touch here with the live show on Twitch. You can always follow us right down to become a follower of twitch.tv/overclockingTV channels. Don't forget, you can also give a follow to the Intel channel that is hosting us all this week for this HWBot World Tour 2016. And of course, you can find us on all the social media on the interweb.
Okay,
my dear
Ligot,
it was a pleasure to discuss and comment this match with you. I can't wait to be tomorrow to do the last face-off of this week before we go and tune into Saturday's final.
Yeah, Saturday will be like a long stream, and there will be a lot of matches, not only the experts or the extreme overclockers, but we always see a show-off between the amateurs as well.
Indeed. So we will see all that on Saturday, but until next time and the short break, keep pushing it.